welcome. You're watching this special broadcast right here on NDTV 24/7. I'm Sonal Mehrotra Kapoor. On the show, we'll be addressing some of the questions people have regarding COVID vaccination at a time when India is already looking at a possible second wave, and vaccination is key. What are the basic things that you need to keep in mind? And this will continue as we have an expert panel for you. We'll be going across to our doctors where we talk about living long and healthy with COVID vaccination. Let me introduce my panel now. We've got Dr. Parimal Taide with us. He's a consultant in Nagpur. We've got Dr. Krishan Dilampadi, he's a consultant and he joins us from Bengaluru. We also have Dr. Milind Kharche and he joins us from Aurangabad. So quite a mix of doctors across the country we have. Thank you so much for your time and taking us through all these answers today. Let me begin by bringing in Dr. Parimal Taide at this point. Doctor, my first question is that what a lot of people don't understand is the different ways in which Covishield and Covaxin and the tech really works. Could you explain that to our viewers, please?
There are two vaccines currently being used in India against COVID-19. One is called Covaxin and the other is called Covishield. Covaxin is an inactivated vaccine. It was developed by Bharat Biotech in collaboration with National Institute of Virology and Indian Council of Medical Research. It uses a platform of dead virus, what we call whole virion inactivated verocell derived platform technology. So basically it contains a dead virus, so it cannot cause any infection, but it can instruct the immune system to mount a reaction against infection. Now the second vaccine is Covishield. It uses a viral vector platform. It was developed by Serum Institute and it uses a common cold virus in chimpanzees. It is used as a vector to carry the spike proteins of COVID-19 into the host, human cells, and that mounts the immune response. When the vaccine is injected into the patient, it prompts the immune system to start making antibodies and primes it to attack against any coronavirus infection. So you train the immune system to recognize the threat.
Let me bring in Dr. Krishan on the program. Doc, if you could talk about one question that is really on everybody's mind about the side effects and the common side effects of the vaccine. Whatever little amount of vaccine hesitancy we've seen has been because of that. And but in particular, people with diabetes, do they need to be careful about something?
As an endocrinologist myself, I am faced with the plenty of queries regarding the side effects of COVID-19 vaccine. As such, I would like to say that side effects are pretty mild and these side effects get resolved in a couple of days. So some of the common side effects which are rarely encountered are fever, there might be pain at injection site, generalized body aches, myalgia, mild headache might be there. So coming to your second part of the question, that is with respect to people with diabetes, they don't pose any unique challenges for them to receive COVID-19 vaccine. I strongly recommend people with diabetes to take COVID-19 vaccine, because we all know that the severity of COVID-19 illness is quite more in diabetes patients. Hence, by taking vaccine, the severity of COVID-19 infection can be reduced.
Let me bring in Dr. Milind to the conversation now. Dr. Milind, one of the key questions, especially for me also, has been that how long does the vaccine continue to give you protection against the virus? We've talked about antibodies, and if you get COVID, if you fight COVID, we know how long that lasts, and it changes in every individual. What is the case with vaccines?
As far as the duration of the protection with the COVID vaccination is, whatever data we have till date suggests that we are going to get protection at least for a few months to a year. Means the earliest trial was started in March 19 and now it's almost an year. So we can say that that vaccine provide protection for at least an year. There are recent trials started for third booster dose also in Western countries. So these trials will answer our question whether additional booster doses are required and whether they will prolong the duration for which these vaccinations are going to protect us. But yes, at this point of time, we can say that whatever the protection we have for at least 70 to 90% of the protection from infection, and those who got infected, they have mild disease. So even if those who got infection after vaccination would be mild, and that's why it's very necessary to get vaccinated without caring about the duration of the vaccine, protection that vaccines gives to us.
We talked about people with diabetes, if they need to be careful about something, but what about people with thyroid conditions? Do they need to stop vaccination? Do they need to stop their medication, like your parent, if they're going in for vaccination? Dr. Parivar Taide, if you could take that question, please.
The commonest thyroid disorders in community are hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism. So either the gland is not producing adequate amount of hormone, or it is producing more than required amount of hormone. And so patients are on treatment for both these conditions. Now, all these patients can take the vaccine safely. There is no need to consider stopping medication on the day of vaccination. So the hypothyroid individuals, they should take their thyroxine tablet on the morning of taking vaccine. And similarly, the hyperthyroid patient should also take their antithyroid drugs as prescribed by the doctor on the day of vaccinations.
But what about blood thinners, doctor? That has been a major area of concern, that people who are already on blood thinners, do they need to go and consult their doctors around the time they're getting their vaccination?
Yeah. So for blood thinners like aspirin and clopidogrel, which most patients are on, there are really no problems. So the usual patients with ischemic heart disease who are on aspirin or clopidogrel, they can go ahead with vaccination.
All right, let's at this point slip into a break. When we come back, we've got more questions that we'll ask our expert panel to shed some light on. Stay tuned with us. Welcome back. You're watching NTV special broadcast, where we are taking lots of questions and having them answered by an expert group of doctors about the vaccination process and what you need to keep in mind. Let's continue with that now. Let me bring in Dr. Milind. And Dr. Milind, any specific or special advice do you have to patients who have recently undergone angioplasty? Is it safe for them to take the vaccine?
I would like to clarify that patient who have undergone an elective angioplasty is absolutely not a contraindication for COVID-19 vaccination. They can take vaccine very safely. So they should go ahead if they are eligible according to the present norms of the government. They should go ahead and take the vaccine, and it's safe to take the vaccine. Those who have undergone emergency angioplasty, I would suggest them to get in touch with their cardiologist, just discuss with him and go ahead with the vaccination. It's not like that they cannot take vaccine or should not take vaccine. They should take vaccine, but as it was an emergency, it's better to get in touch with the treating cardiologist and then take the COVID-19 vaccination. I would suggest every heart patient should take COVID-19 vaccine whenever they are eligible.
Right. And Doc, would you say that applies to anybody who has undergone an operation recently, since they could be more vulnerable to the virus?
Actually, if it's not an emergency or planned operation, I think they can go ahead and take the vaccine. If it's an emergency or an acute illness, then the vaccine guide at present recommend to wait for a few weeks, but it varies from patient to patient, and such patients are advised to get in touch with their treating doctor and then decide the exact timing of the vaccine. But they should take vaccine whenever it is appropriate according to their consulting physician or a doctor.
All right. It's an important clarification for on that. Thank you for that. Let me bring in Dr. Parivar on that one. You know, we talked about diabetes earlier, but any advice for people who have severe diabetes and complications like retinopathy that have been doing the rounds on whether or not that can occur? Could you sort of declutter all the myths here, please?
So if a patient has diabetic retinopathy, it is suggestive of advanced diabetes or a diabetes with complication, because retinopathy is a microvascular complication of diabetes. So now when such individuals develop COVID infection, they are more likely to suffer from severe infection with complications. Then they are more likely to stay in hospital for a longer duration of time, and the risk of death is also high in this subgroup of individuals. So the best thing that we can do would be to, if you could just prevent the infection from happening, that is the best thing.
Let me move on now and get a couple of more questions in. Dr. Kishan, if you could answer, especially those who are patients and people on hormonal treatment. Women across ages now have been diagnosed with PCOD, with PCOS. They take hormonal treatments as well. For them, is there a particular thing that they need to keep in mind?
Hormonal therapy basically includes people who are taking estrogen and progesterone for a variety of conditions like PCOS, that is polycystic ovarian syndrome, menopausal symptoms. So in this group of people, vaccination is not contraindicated, and if they are under eligible criteria, definitely they should go for COVID-19 vaccine. Also in men who are taking testosterone replacement therapy, particularly who have a condition known as hypogonadism, where their male sexual hormone levels are very low. In this set of patients who are on testosterone injections, for them also, COVID vaccine is not contraindicated. So in people who are taking hormonal therapy, there is no contraindications to COVID-19 vaccine. And COVID-19 vaccine per se does not have any interaction with these hormonal therapy. So they should be quite sure that there are no issues for taking COVID-19 vaccine.
Let me bring in Dr. Milind now for the next question. Dr. Milind, the vaccinations, you talk about how blood thinners, you need to consult your doctors and every patient is going to be different. But what about antiplatelet therapy? Any special instructions for them during the vaccination process?
Yeah, so actually blood thinners and COVID-19 vaccine somehow made to be a controversial, and I need to clear the air about it. I want to. So there are two types of blood thinner, as you rightly mentioned. Antiplatelets are one of them, and antiplatelets like aspirin, clopidogrel and ticagrelor are absolutely safe, and the patient who are taking these medicines can take vaccines even without consulting their doctor. The other type of blood thinners are like anticoagulants. The warfarin or acetocaumarin are the older anticoagulant for which you require to monitor INR. If you are taking these medicines, then yes, you need to consult your doctor. Your doctor will assess the bleeding risk and will decide the appropriate time to take the vaccine. If you are taking newer oral anticoagulants like dabigatran or rivaroxaban, again, it's safe to take COVID vaccine, and you can take COVID vaccine safely, but we recommend that you consult with your treating doctor once before taking the vaccine. But for antiplatelet, surely you should continue it before, during and after vaccination. It is harmful to stop this medication for vaccination also.
Dr. Pariwal, if you could address another one that has come to us about women with gestational diabetes. What about them? Do they need to be in a special category, or are they good to go for the vaccination?
Yeah, so women with gestational diabetes, they need to keep their sugars in control. That is something which we are very certain about. Now, regarding vaccination, there is a controversy, and I will tell you both sides. So, the American College of Obstetrician and Gynecologist, American Society for Reproductive Medicine, and the Society for Maternal and Fetal Medicine, all of them unanimously recommend that pregnant women can go ahead with vaccination. Now, why do they say so? Because when pregnant ladies get COVID infection, it is usually more severe and the risk of death is more in pregnant women. That is why these organizations say that pregnant ladies should undergo vaccination. Now, the problem is, in the trials, pregnant ladies were not enrolled. So we really do not know how these women are going to react to the vaccine and what is going to be the outcome, so long as the fetal issues are concerned. So this is a gray area. That is why the best thing would be to judge each patient on an individual basis, and a discussion with the treating gynecologist can be really helpful. If the lady is socially active, needs to go out of the home for work, and is at high risk of getting the COVID infection, then it is worthwhile considering vaccination for her. But against this, if she is she has restricted physical activity and is sort of not socially so active and at a lower risk of getting COVID, then in this patient probably we can avoid vaccination, because we do not have really a long-term safety data to explain this further.
All right, so that was good to know, actually. Let's get in the last question, really. Dr. Milind, if you could talk to us a little bit more about a lot of queries that come on heart diseases, hypertension, and the blood clots, really, that has been a cause of concern across the world. Something that is really led into whatever little amount of vaccine hesitation we have. Could you address that issue and why exactly blood clot is such a major thing that is being seen with the vaccination process?
Actually, I would want to clarify about blood clots first because it's in controversy. And there were few reports of having blood clots or severe blood clots patients who received COVID-19 vaccine in Europe. But it was almost... They were having almost an 8 cases of severe thrombosis and 21 cases of mild thrombus or mild clots in almost 30 million cases total.
Right.
So the incidence was very less, and what the data means, European medical body has said that the incidence of thrombosis or clot is lower than that which is found in the general population.
Okay.
And it is not exactly a causal relationship. Means you cannot say that that blood clot is directly related to the vaccine. There is no evidence at present. So I think the risk of having blood clot is much, much, much less than the having severe COVID infection in these patients, because patients with heart disease, patients with hypertension, if they contract COVID-19 infection, they are very likely to have severe COVID infection. And the risk of having severe COVID infection is going to be much higher than the having of risk of having blood clot. So I would strongly advise for the patients who are having heart disease or those who are having hypertension to get vaccinated. And another important point is they should continue their medicines of heart disease and hypertension during vaccination. There is no need to stop that, and there is no need to fear about the blood clots, because the incidence of blood clot is very less, and it is very less than the mortality we are getting for the COVID-19 infection in heart disease patient in our country also. So I would strongly recommend to get vaccinated for these people.
Put in a second counter question to that, really, because we are seeing blood clots only in a particular vaccine being reported. Is that a matter of concern then?
Yeah, actually, that was reported in a particular vaccine. And whatever clarification was given, it was given about that particular vaccine also. So almost between 30 million, there were total almost 33 or 30 cases only. And the incidence which is found with these vaccine or the blood clot with this vaccine, that particular vaccine was also lower than the incidence of blood clot in the total population.
That's
and
true.
There was no definite causal relationship with that, except one out, and it's not proven. They are still evaluating what data they have released, the supervising body of the Europe, the medical body of the Europe. They say that it is not related causally to the vaccine, and that's why in Europe also they are continuing with the vaccination, with the same vaccine also and other vaccines also. So I think in our country also, we need not to fear about it. And I would strongly recommend to continue with that vaccine.
With that, we've come to the end of today's program. Thank you, all the three doctors, for taking on all those questions, really. So this is the program wherein we try to bring an answer to all the common queries people have regarding the vaccination process. We hope this was helpful. We'll see you again. Bye-bye.